this morning? Well, wonderful. That is good to hear. We are pumped that you braved the Rona and come on to our actual piece of geography here. And we like this space. We love this space. We're going to worship the Lord here in a moment. And I want to remind you again of different experiences that are in this room. You got a dark, ominous thing bothering you or somebody in your family. You can go back there in private and light a candle and read some of the scriptures over there. It's a good space. I make use of that space. And then over here, if you have a need, I've already seen a couple things written down there. So you got a need. We're praying that God would open up the windows of heaven. I had that joy this week of bringing a bunch of requests that you guys left over there. I had the opportunity to pray for those things this week, and I consider that a joy to join with you and asking God to meet your needs. And then over here, what an experience that is. You got something just bugging you. The devil's trying to put it in your face. Go over there and you'll see it disappears the way it's supposed to disappear when you're in the presence of Jesus. Amen. So if you would please stand to your feet with me, and we're going to have an incredible time of worship. Is it good to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. It is absolutely awesome to be in the house of the Lord. We're so glad that you're here. I'm going to pray, and these very capable lead prompters are going to lead us. Remember, it's not that they're up here on a stage in a performance. These are just folks like you, friends, and they love the Lord, and they use their gifts to praise the Lord, and it helps us to join in with them and experience God in a powerful way. Because the Bible makes it really clear. He says he inhabits the praises of his people. Somebody asked me one time, where is God? I said, follow me to church. I said, he's everywhere, but I know a unique place he shows up. Where? In the praises of his people. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you that you do show up in the praises of your people. The world would have us, constantly griping, constantly down, and it does that to us sometimes, God. It just can be so draining. As you said, in this world you will have tribulation. You know, you've been here, God, in the person of Jesus, and now we've come to be in your presence, to praise you, and we know what's going to happen. We're going to make you smile, and then you, in turn, through your presence, you're going to make us smile. You're going to make our soul smile. We love you, and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Down. Thank you.
Doesn't take any convincing to me that song is absolutely true. God is worthy of it all. Lord, our great God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, we've taken time to bless and praise your holy name. We thank you for the way in which your Spirit has begun that incredible work in us when we do gather, and how we feel invigorated, Lord. God, you said it's a bubbling brook coming up out of us, that you're doing that work through the power of your Holy Spirit. So we thank you for your presence. We thank you for the truth and the songs, God, and where they took us. And now at this place, Lord, attune our hearts to your word, that we might worship you even deeper still. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. And again, let this worship team know how much you just love the way they help you worship the Lord. They are just incredible. I love them. I like being here early and listening to them practice. It's incredible. Praise the Lord. Thank you so much for coming. We are grateful that you are here. I see my buddy Shane back there. Love you, brother. He's one of our faithful that comes on Wednesday night when we have our prayer meeting. And Billy was with us this past Wednesday night. And Tim and Cindy are usually always there. I think you're traveling this week. And it's just good to see everybody. Nathan, good to see you, brother. Man, that's my man right there, bro. And Timmy and I are starting a small group Bible study at our house on Thursday nights. It's really a gathering to encourage and inspire young couples. So we love to have you come, Nathan, and Levi and all them are coming. So it's going to be some good stuff. But so good to be here. Amen. The body of the Lord is doing its thing at Oakleaf. Amen. There are other groups that are meeting, and there's good stuff that's happening. There's an energy because God is faithful. I know you know this, but I'm going to go ahead and just say it again. The tomb in Jerusalem is empty. Amen. Amen. And that means the throne in heaven is occupied by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And what that means to us is we have great hope today. Amen. We have great hope. You know, sometimes you look at some of the news headlines lately, and you may be thinking, that don't give us much hope. I don't know if you watch the news much or if you listen to talk radio much, but man, there's some crazy stuff out there. Recently, somebody said, how did they say, I want to get it right. They said, could we as a society get any more dumber, quote unquote? Now, before you think that's such a harsh accusation, I invite you to give your attention to our screens up here, and I want to show you a couple of headlines of our nation's newspapers. Are you ready for this? There's a ton of these, but I'm only doing about five of them, but check these headlines out. Remember the quote, could we get any more dumber, quote unquote. This is one, bugs flying around with wings are flying bugs. Really? Really? And there's another one, the second one that's coming up here. Check this one out. Federal agents raid gun shop and find weapons. Who would have thought that they would have found weapons, right? Are you kidding me? Here's another one. I like this one. China may be using sea to hide its submarines. No, come on, are you kidding me? And I love this one. This is my favorite. This is good. We hate math, say 4 in 10, a majority of Americans. I'm terrible at math, but I knew they got that wrong. And here's my favorite. This is my all-time favorite. This is crazy. Breathing oxygen linked to staying alive. I don't believe it. I mean, come on, that's crazy. Well, welcome to Oak Leaf. We are in our 8th installment of our series titled, We Are Oak Leaf, an Identity Refresher. And this morning, the message is entitled, it's titled this, We Are Oak Leaf and We Are Wise. We are Oak Leaf and we are wise. The infallible and errant, inspired, authoritative Word of God says this. It says this, check this out. Proverbs 4:7. It says this, above all, before all, do this, get wisdom. Take that in for a second. Did you hear the urgency and did you catch the priority? Check it out. Above all, that's some an urgency right there. And before all, there's the priority. Above all and before all, do this. It's something you must do. It doesn't happen through osmosis. It doesn't happen through you just saying that you have this. No, there's something you've got to do. Get wisdom. Now, if the Bible's telling us that we should be the people that are going to, like, go get wisdom, right? Well, we should have a working definition of what wisdom is that can help us. There's a lot of definitions out there, and as I was studying this week, there were so many of them, I just sat there and I said, God, but what would you have us to believe wisdom really is? And this is what I came up with. Listen to this. This is a working definition of wisdom. Knowledge and the capacity to make the very best of it, very best of that knowledge, in light of eternity. That's wisdom. That's wisdom. Knowledge and the capacity to make the very best of it in light of eternity. See, we are a people, we are a faith family who together seek knowledge and help each other to make the very best use of it in light of eternity. That is a great group of people that I would love to be around. Amen. If you can hang out with those kind of people, because, you know, people say you become like the people that you hang around or like the books that you read or the movies that you watch. It has an effect on your life. So that's what's so awesome and so powerful about the Oak Leaf Faith Family is that we exist to get knowledge, and then as we acquire it, we position ourselves in each other's lives to help us make the very best use of it in light of eternity. Proverbs 9:10 says this, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So it starts right there. It starts, first of all, remember I said we're a faith family. It's grounded in this, a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It's grounded in accepting and receiving this massive gift of eternal life and love that God has extended to the world through the Lord Jesus Christ. And you get that simply by stop arguing with God about your sin. Don't argue with him about it. Just agree with him about it. You're a sinner. Amen. Don't look at me goofy. You're a sinner, and I'm a sinner. And it's a good day when we stop arguing about that. We agree with it, and the God of the universe says, hey, now you're my child. Follow me. And as we engage in our relationship with God, we're acquiring knowledge, and then we're going to help each other to make the very best use of it in light of eternity. Now, fear of God doesn't mean like we're afraid he's going to get us. Like, fear of God. No, it's a specific sense of respect, awe. And that respect and awe results in a submission to a deity. And we believe that Jesus Christ is God. He was a real historical figure, walked on this earth, lived the sinless life. They butchered him on a cross. They buried him. And 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And it's been about 2,000 years since that thing happened. And nobody has been able to dispute the reality of the resurrection. He is Lord. He is God. And so this morning, we're going to review how we as a faith family help each other in this worthwhile, life-enhancing, God-honoring endeavor of acquiring wisdom, knowledge, and helping each other make the best use of it in light of eternity. Amen. I'm reminded of a story of someone who needed wisdom. It was back in the days when, you know, castles and kingdoms covered the land, especially the castle of Pembroke, the Pembroke Castle in England. King James was there, and he decided that he was going to throw this massive, huge ball in one of his glorious banquet halls. The decorations were opulent. The offerings that he had for everybody were extravagant, incredibly extravagant. 50-foot tables held silver trays full of plump, ripe fruits, tasty meats, delicious cheeses, succulent desserts, and of course they had an abundance of ale. Ladies in their long, enchanting, elegant gowns, and gentlemen dressed in their handsome regal suits, they danced and made merry while some singers, musicians, and a court jester entertained them. The story goes that the court jester, Mr. Comedian, went a little too far with his jokes, and he offended the king. And the king became so furious, he sentenced him to be executed. Well, the crowd didn't like that, so they prayed upon the king. King, please, give the guy a break. Give him some mercy. For so many years, he's done an incredible good job, and he's always brought us great cheer and joy. Please. And after much, the crowds are begging him, the king finally did relent, but only to one little small space. He said, okay, but the only thing I'm going to do is I'm going to allow that jester to be able to decide what way he would like to die. And the court jester begged for one night, man. He said, give me one night. I want to beg God for wisdom on how I should die. And they threw him in his dungeon, and there he begged God for wisdom. And in the midnight hour, God did grant him wisdom. The next morning, the guards showed up. They grabbed the jester, took him to the king's throne, threw him at the feet of the king's throne. The king stood up above him and roared and said, what way have you chosen to die? And the court jester very humbly said, if it's all the same to you, my lord, I would like to die of old age. That is wisdom. That is acquiring knowledge and making the very best use of it in light of eternity. How do we get wisdom that we need for our lives? And not just for dying. I mean, the Bible's full of great wisdom about dying. I mean, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but hello, have everlasting life. I mean, that one verse alone is an incredible insight about your life and that eternity is coming and you're going to die. But what about the wisdom that we need for everyday life? What about the wisdom that we need as husbands, you need as wives, that you need as students? We need as employees and employers. What about the wisdom we need just to be, solid citizens in our society? How do we get that? Well, there are three biblical steps that we take as a faith family to acquire wisdom. I'm going to share those with you because we are Oakleaf, an identity refresher. These will be great things to refresh you on what we do in order to get knowledge and then make the very best use of it in light of eternity. There are three steps to this. Here's the very first step. Number one, we yield our will to God. It's the very first step. We yield our will to God. Jesus set the supreme example, didn't he, in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was talking to his father before the cross? What did he say? He said, not my will, but your will be done. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul gives us an incredible insight as to the posture that we're supposed to have as it relates to yielding our will to God. He says this, therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of the mercies of God, stop right there, hold on. Don't pass that by. You know what? He's about to ask us something big, but before he does, he wants you to take a look at something bigger. Amen. He says, hey, I need you to look over your shoulder for a moment and look at how good God's been to you. Amen. I need you to look over your shoulder and see if there's been any moments in your life where God gave you mercy. What is that? God didn't give you what you do deserve in judgment. And by the way, that's equal for all of us. Why? Because we deserve death and hell for our sins. The wages of sin is death, except the God of the universe, we talked about it last week, but God demonstrated his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He took our caning for us on the cross of Calvary. Remember that last week? Amen. So we can look back over our shoulders, see the amazing mercy of God. And what Paul is saying, would you let that be a catalyst for you to do what I'm about to ask you to do, because it's going to be pretty tough. I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is true worship. And do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so you may discern. Do you see that? Discern, get the knowledge, get the understanding, get the thing that can break the code about something. And what is that something? The good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. Everybody wants to know, man, what's God's will about this? What's God's will about that? Well, first, to get it, he says you'll find it. But you got to be able to posture yourself in the right place. And the very first thing we do is yield our will to God. Now, we can be stubborn and act on our limited knowledge. Or, hello, we don't have to be like the headlines. We can, instead, we can tap into somebody who possesses all knowledge. No, that's the Bible. That's what the Bible's telling us we have the opportunity to do. God isn't up in heaven just holding on to his godness. He wants to share it with you. God wants to share his godness with you. He wants to share with you that knowledge that he has. And he can share it with you. But we have to yield our will to God. I'll never forget after 9/11. I remember how I was so just peeled to the television. Maybe you were too. Watching the rubble in New York City. I had an uncle that was a fire chief up there, and he was helping with the rescue efforts. And I remember just, man, I hope they find somebody. I hope they find somebody, because it won't be long and it will move from, you know, rescue to just finding recovery, finding somebody. And so I hope they find people. And they did, in fact. They actually rescued 11 people. 11 people. You know, I noticed something about all the 11 people that were rescued. None of them, as they were trapped in the rubble, none of them, when the first responders got to them, none of them looked at the rescuers and said, hey, I got this. I know my way out. Matter of fact, why don't you follow me? Nobody did that. You know what they did? They submitted themselves to the knowledge of the rescuer and said, you know what? You know the way out. I don't have a clue. I'm completely dependent upon you. That's what the Apostle Paul is saying in Romans 12, 1 and 2. Man, recognize, and we as a faith family do, we recognize our complete dependency upon God. We are doomed without God. Doomed without God. But when we yield our will to God, then God is the great rescuer. He said he loves to engage in our lives, and he will, in fact, lead us. And when we decide to say, I'm going to yield my will to God, then the next thing that you're going to find out is he's going to invite you to ask him for wisdom. We yield our will to God. First, we humble ourselves. Humble ourselves. Well, I just don't like asking anybody help. Well, you better ask God for help. You can get that little pride out of yourself, and you better get humble and ask God. Yield your will to God. And then when you do, the next thing God says to do is to ask him for wisdom. We get this from the Apostle James, the half-brother of Jesus, who said in James 1:5, now if any of you lacks wisdom, let me just stop it there for a second, that would be all of us. I don't know. I don't really feel like I'm lacking at this moment in my life. Well, what he's saying is, if unless you possess all knowledge, you lacking. You're lacking. So guess what? Admit that. And then come to God. He should ask God, who God gives to all, everybody say all generously and ungrudgingly. And listen, and it will be given you. See, God will give us wisdom. We just need to take him up on what he reveals to us. I'm looking for an answer. I'm looking for the way out of this. I'm looking for some insight. Some of the, okay, ask God for wisdom and he will reveal it to you, but then you've got to do what he reveals. If you don't, it could be troubling. In 1860, a gold miner by the name of Tug Ward found gold in Icetop Gap, Montana, a boom town erected but only lasted a short spell because of the deadly harsh winters. See, back then, old mountain men could predict the way that the weather would be, and when they would predict and could get an insight that a winter was going to be uninhabitable, they would warn the city so that they could go south and survive. Well, this town was way off of the beaten path, and it was lost in time until some travelers stumbled across it in the spring of 1920, some 70 years later. In one of the rooms on top of the city saloon, they found a mass of man's bones in a bed and several small bags of gold under the covers. The ledger at the salon gave them incredible insights as to the mystery of who that man was and what was that about. The ledger said in room 5, the room that he was in room 5, it said this: Young Jack Know-It-All Garrison. In the ledger, Young Jack Know-It-All Garrison, paid in full for 2 months when the town evacuated due to incoming deadly winter that the mountain men said was coming. See, we at Oak Leaf aren't Jack Know-It-Alls. Somebody should have said amen right there. Come on. I said, we at Oak Leaf are not Jack Know-It-Alls. We ask for wisdom. We ask it from each other, and we especially ask it from God. You know, that's why we have a prayer meeting here in this space on Wednesday nights at 6:30. We have a prayer meeting in the Emory Room. Our elders had got birthed in their heart that we need to be praying during the season. And we're meeting there, and right now we're small in number. I beg you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, join us on Wednesdays. Well, I'm busy and I got this, I got that. Well, hold on one. Would you like to have something that if you did it, it would absolutely revolutionize your life? Of course you would. That's why you're in America. It's capitalism. You can get it by watching TV. Go get your product. Go get your thing at the store. We buy things to make our life better. In the name of God, don't just push back on prayer. We've got to be a people of corporate prayer, and we're doing it. We're doing it. It's powerful, I'm telling you. It's one of my highlights of the week. It's so powerful. It's incredible. Because listen. We as a faith family agree. God forbid that we, like Young Jack Know-It-All Garrison, deny the signs of the times, gain the treasures of this world, only to rot away and have history discover our poor decisions. We're not going to be like Young Jack Know-It-All. Let me tell you what America's full of: Young Jack Know-It-Alls. You don't believe it? Go watch some people's Facebook post. Everybody's got their opinion. Well, it's changed, okay? If you haven't noticed, it's not an opinion anymore. It's a gospel. I'm preaching. Amen. And so it would behoove you — that's a good little southern word I like — it would behoove you and behoove me that we would get to a place where we would go, oh my gosh, God, because it's not like, you know, somebody just is a Jack Know-It-All because that's just who they are. No, you grow into one, because that's what Paul said. Don't you be conformed to this world. You know what the world does? The world tries to get you at a place, get an education, get all your knowledge, and guess what? You've got all the resources. You can be your own God. You'll be fine. Your own life's going to be great. Don't worry about any of it. No. The God of the universe flips all that. Sure, get your education. Sure, do what you can to get it studied. Sure, get all that stuff. But be humble before God. Don't be a Jack know-it-go. And listen, don't, whatever you do, don't deny the signs of the times. See, little Jack know-it-all, you know what he did? He didn't listen to the mountain men. It's coming. It's coming. It's going to be bad. It's coming. It's amazing to me how there used to be a season in the world where the man of God, even though they were flawed in their lives, but they would stand and they would proclaim the word of God. Not the, our own message on our own, but the word of God. And the word of God goes forth and says, listen, this world is passing away. Don't get your little bags of gold and tuck them underneath the covers of your home. Don't do it. You'll rot away only to have history to discover your poor decision. That will not happen at Oakleaf Church. That will never be the story and the testimony of Oakleaf Church. That will never be a headline in America about Oakleaf Church. Amen. Why? Because we ask God for wisdom. We ain't stupid. Amen. I might look goofy, but I ain't stupid. I'm going to go to God and I'm going to ask him. And listen, when you do, there's a final step. Seek wisdom in God's word. Seek wisdom in God's word. Because a lot of times, this is what we do. You read more books about the Bible than you do the Bible. I guarantee you, you have read more books about everything else more than you have ever read the Bible. But I read the Bible once. Well, it's not made for reading once. As a matter of fact, I would propose to you that if you read it once, you got very confused. It takes gatherings of people to get into this book and understand the knowledge of this book. And that's why we're faith family, because then we can help each other to get this knowledge. And then look, now we go make the very best use of it in light of what? Our net worth? No, eternity. But we got to seek it in God's word. Psalms 119:105 is one of my favorite verses. It said this: your word is a lamp for my feet and a light on my path. When my two oldest were younger, Christy and Will, they were 8 and 10. I did a lot of youth camps across America. I did a lot of different events. And I got invited to go do this youth camp in North Carolina. And I took them with me. They went to a bunch of camps. And they, you know, sometimes don't ask them for pizza because they're like, I had it most of my life. They don't want it. So we're in camp, doing our camp thing. They had excursions that week, pretty cool excursions. And one of them was to go, they called it spelunking. Now, I didn't know what spelunking was, so I signed up for it. And and so we go off, and I heard it was going to be exploring a cave. So cool. So I'm, you know, we go into the woods forever and forever and forever, and I'm looking for, like, you know, the side of a mountain with a big hole in it, you know, a cave. So the God's given us, we stop, the God's given us instructions and everything, we're putting gear on, all this stuff. And I'm like, where's the cave? And he goes, it's right there. It was a hole in the ground. I was like, what? There ain't no cave, that's a hole in the ground. He goes, yeah, wait. And so we slithered into that hole, all of us and my kids. If my wife knew I was doing it, she would have killed me at that moment right there. When we slid into that hole, and I remember the pungent, damp smell of dirt and it was just pitch black, and the guy turned on the lamp, and next thing you know is we're twisting and winding through all these narrow buried caverns. And at one spot, for about 50 feet, we were navigating a stretch where the wall was here, and we're kind of scooting. And for me, it was waist-high water, but for my kids, it was neck-high water, muddy water, and it's dark. And we're going through, and in the middle of that, we'd been in the cave for about 2 hours now. And so we're in muddy water to my waist, it's up to my kids' neck. I can't even see them. I know the guy's in the front. He's got a little headlamp on. And then all of a sudden, the only thing we could see, because he turned his headlamp off. And we were mobbed by darkness. That's the only thing, mobbed. Have you ever been mobbed by darkness? We were mobbed by darkness. When the blood-curdling scream stopped, which would seem like 5 minutes of it, we were nuts. I was screaming, you know, and I was trying to be brave for my kids. I'm like, this is crazy. And then after we calmed down, the guy goes, okay, now try to find your way out of here. And like, you know, a kind, thoughtful minister would do, I said, if you don't turn your headlamp back on, I'm going to baptize you in this muddy water, and you ain't getting up. You better get that headlamp back on, bro. And he did. He turned the headlamp back on. We did make it out safe. And as we were out of the, you know, spunking hole, and I remember looking at his little headlamp. It was so small. but it had such tremendous power over darkness. And it was a resource of life for us. See, that's God's word for us. That is what God's word is for us. Listen, you got to understand. See, the word of God is the same thing for us as we're navigating the dark caverns of uncertainty, and we need light to help us move past the muddy waters of our daily issues. Amen. It's the word of God. And we at Oakleaf, we seek wisdom in God's word. You may come and go, why does that guy get up there and he's kind of hollering a little bit and he's talking and he keeps throwing these scriptures thing out? Because we're in God's word. We're engaging in God's word, and God's word is a lamp for our feet and it is a light unto our path. Let's circle back real quick. Remember the jester? Sought wisdom for one night, and then the next day comes out and he goes, if it's all the same to you, my Lord, I would like to die of old age. Wow. Wow. See, what we didn't know about the story is that while in his dungeon, he had access to parchments. They were sheets of scriptures that King James was using to make the King James Bible. And the guard was a Christian. And so he would take some of those parchments and he would give them to some of the men coming, the inmates coming into the dungeon, and it might help them settle their soul about their punishment. And it was that, in that scenario, that the jester's in there with some parchments, asking God for wisdom. And his eyes fell upon these verses, Genesis 15:15. As for yourself, you shall go to your fathers in peace. You shall be buried after a ripe old age. Have you ever needed a word from God? He did. And he got it. Wow. I'm going to tell the king I want to die of old age. This is crazy. Thank you, God. Score. Amen. You ever needed a word from God? He's given it to you. Your Bibles. And we've got to be the people that would take the time to get into his book more than we get into those books. I'm not against books. I've written four of them. I'm not against them at all. They're helpful tools that can help you. But where is the allegiance of your heart? Is it to the word of God? We as a faith family, we are Oakleaf and we are wise. And the reason we are wise is because we yield our will to God. We help each other do that. I thank my brothers in here that helped me do that. Saturday mornings, I meet with men, and we help each other to yield our wills to God. And then, you know what we do? We seek God, and we ask God for wisdom. We pray, man. I do. I invite you. Come on Wednesdays at 6:30 to this place. I have a vision of this place being so packed on Wednesday's night of people that we have to move in here, getting on our knees before God and seeing God do supernatural, phenomenal works, because he's still the same God and he says he can still do it. Amen. And most of the time when he's done it super abundantly, it's been when our nation has been in crisis. Hello. And we have it. Maybe you've not heard about it yet. Maybe you've not heard about it online, but I'm just asking you. Do this. Before now and Wednesday, I ask everyone in the room, you pray about coming to pray and listen to God. Some of you can't do it. I fully understand that. But you know what? I was told a long time ago by Beth Moore in a conference in Texas. She said this, and she was preaching. I'm telling you, she was getting after it. This is what she said. She said, you have all the God you want. You have all the God you want. Where are you, God? God, this is hard. God, this is crazy. And God, where are you, God? I doubt God. I just doubt God. Wait. Have you been yielding your will to him? Are you asking him for wisdom? Oh, and then don't just ask it and then leave it on him, because he says, okay, wait. Now you need to seek it in my word. Why did he do it that way? Because I can tell you this, when I had a long-distance relationship with Tammy, I learned more about Tammy and our long-distance relationship than I did when we were closer together. Why? Because she was getting really detailed in these incredibly awesome letters she was sending me. Amen. And I was in Dallas, Texas. She was in Jacksonville, Florida. And man, she's just writing this stuff. And I'm learning, you know, beyond just, hey, well, you want to go get a cup of coffee and hang out and look at each other? Because you sure are pretty. No, I'm learning her soul. I think it's extraordinary that our God, he is not stupid, by the way. He decided to canonize the word and then lay it out to us and say, I would love for us to have this relationship. And I know I'm, you know, seated in the heavens right now and you're down there on earth, but I can tell you through my word, I can get real close to you. I can get really, really close. And you can get incredibly close to me. Well, I did something this week that God laid it on my heart. I was planning on it being my fifth book. I have a strategy that I use every week, and I've done it for years, because I had an elderly man by the name of Murray Ashwell. You'll hear his name mentioned several times when I'm preaching. And he told me, he said, Tony, whatever you do, as you're in school and you're gonna, God's called you into ministry, don't allow all those other books to take the place of the book. And I challenge you, Tony, be a man of prayer, but you pray the word of God. Pray the word of God. And reflect upon the word of God, and say it out loud. Just speak out loud to God, but do his word. And so I over my journey, I've written a thing. I call it 34-3, 34-3. And by the way, these are, I made copies. I could only make like 40-something of them. That's all I could afford. Now we'll try to do some later, but I made them for you. And they're on a table over there and a table over there. And on your way out, you can grab one of these. And if you need one because you didn't get one, if you're in a family, share them. But try to make sure everybody can get one. And if you need some more, then I'll do what I can this next week to try to make some more for you. But 34:3 is Psalms 34:3. It says, oh, come magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I wrote that on a piece of paper and gave it to Tammy when I asked her to marry me. She just read it and she's like, oh, come magnify the Lord with me, let's exalt his name together. Huh. I was like, no, come magnify the Lord. You know? And really what I always am reminded of is that verse is God inviting us to magnify him together and to exalt his name together. And so what I have here is Sunday through Sunday, for Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, I have scriptures, and they're not just a scripture out, just whatever. I've collaged some scriptures if they're about the same subject. And like on this day, Sunday, it says, I'm going to pause. And it says, on this Sunday, I stop working to rest and realign in the goodness of God. And then pronounce. And there's all these verses. This is about, I feast on Jehovah. And I've written out all these verses about Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Tiskanu, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi. And they're all in there. And you just take them and you read them and you just say them out loud to God. And then as you do, then you'll get over to Monday and there'll be more. And Monday is confessions of praise about our Lord Jesus Christ. And there's all these verses just about the Lord Jesus Christ. You just say them out loud to God. And I want to just challenge you to get this today on your way out. And for the next 7 days, I don't know what you're doing for your own God and I time. Some people call it quiet time. Mine's not really quiet, if you've heard. I'd say it out loud. For years and years, I would take this with me when I was out there preaching to those arenas. For 20 years, and I've been in those arenas over and over and over. I'll never forget being in the Georgia Dome. And I got up, and I was like, this one's a little bit bigger. And I got out, and I circled that joke. And all I would do is I would walk. And I would do what I've done for years and years and years. I wake up and I get with God in God's word. And I would just stand and I would say, Lord Jesus, you're the good shepherd. You know your own. You know your own. You come that I might have life and have it abundantly. And you laid down your life for me. I'm your sheep. You are the door of the sheep. I entering through you, I am saved. And I can go in and out and I can find good pasture. I'm just saying that out loud. And then I read more and more and more and more, all these different things. What day I was in. And it was funny because the guys that worked there would be going, like, who's that guy walking, hollering stuff? And then some of them would get close and try to follow me, like, what's that guy doing? What's that guy saying? And then they would hear the word of God. And then several times people come up, you're a preacher. I said, first, I'm a sinner saved by grace. I'm a flawed man, but I'm his. I'm God's. And I believe it's true, but I'm a man, so all this world tries to get me to believe that it's not true, and the world tries to get to drag me down. So what I do is I get up every day and I make sure that I realign and reorient my heart to what is true about my life and what is true about reality, and I say these things out loud to God. And there's people be like, hey, can I come with you for a little bit? They'd walk and I'd just do it. And several times there'd be some old saints of God. They'd be behind me going, uh-huh, amen. Uh-huh, amen. get one of these on your way out. I just want to ask you, for the next 7 days, incorporated in what you do for your God and I time, the technical name is spiritual formation. What are you doing to formulate the God in you? Because he is in you. We are oak leaves, and we are wise. We will never be Jack know-it-alls. That will not be our story. So let's take heed of the mountain men, right? The prophets of old. They have spoken to us loudly and clearly. This world is passing away. But his kingdom will come. His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Let's listen to the prophets. Not hoard ourselves up. Don't fill all your coffers. Hold on to what you got and rot away. And the world just reads your headline one day. They just, God, what a stupid decision. They just wasted all that glory of God. Let's not do that. Let's be the people that will yield our wills to God. We'll ask him for wisdom. We'll seek it in his word. And guess what? We'll find it. And it's going to add treasure to our everyday life. Lord, we love you. We bless you. We praise you. We thank you for your word, God. We ask you, God, in this moment as we sing, God, help our hearts to just beat with the words of the song, Lord God. And may we touch the hem of your garment again, and that changes everything, Lord. Give us the grace and the strength, Lord, to not let COVID be our Lord, but let Christ be our Lord. Yes, God, help us, God, to be concerned and thoughtful and helpful for others. But oh God, I can just see that. I sensed it last night in my sleep. You were just telling me Satan is using COVID. Satan is using fear to try to choke my church. And in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, demons have to flee in the name of Jesus. We know that you're the Lord over the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, God. We know that this thing is real. But God, we also know that you're the God of the universe. You are advancing your church for your glory and your honor. It is real. It is true, God. And we ask you, would you take us, feeble, broken people who are susceptible to germs, God, and they could drag us down. Would you, God, please fill us with your spirit in this season, that we might see something extraordinary happen in Oak Leaf that we never even could dream of. But it's coming, God. History is being made for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Created hands. answers. Thanks for declaring that with me over this church, and hope you guys have an awesome week. See you next time.